Hi everyone. Agriculture. Today's topic what we are going to discuss is agriculture. Agriculture in India is an important occupation. India is basically agriculture dominant country. Two-thirds of its population is engaged in agricultural activities. Agriculture is a primary activity which produces most of the food that we consume. Welcome to Hamsika Academy. Please do subscribe and support us. Now getting into our topics. What are the topics that we are going to discuss in this chapter? The topics include types of farming, major crops, institutional reforms, impact of globalization, present condition of Indian agriculture. Let us see each topic in detail. Types of farming. Can you name some industries based on agricultural raw materials? Immediately we get to an answer, that is tea, coffee and spices. How do we categorize the types of farming? The types of farming is the cultivation methods that have been changed significantly depending upon the characteristics of physical environment, technological knowledge, and socio-cultural practices. The types of farmings are categorized based on the cultivation methods that have been significantly depending on the characteristics of physical environment, technological knowledge, and socio-cultural practices. As the time passed, as the physical environments changed, technological knowledge has to reach to the people, and when the advances have brought certain changes in agriculture that have impacted the socio-cultural practices, so that there are types of changes in farming. Farming varies from subsistence to commercial type. Let us first go to find out what is the subsistence farming. The first subsistence farming is primitive subsistence farming. What is the primitive subsistence farming? In the primitive subsistence farming, the most disturbing factor is the land productivity is very less. The primitive subsistence farming is also known as slash and burn agriculture. Farmers clear a patch of land and produce cereals and other food crops to sustain their family. After a period of time, they move away from that place to another place. Mostly, this type of cultivation is done in monsoon regions and also the areas where the natural fertility of the soil is very high and the suitability of the environmental conditions. What are the products that they use here are small patch of land with the help of primitive tools like hoe, dao and digging stick. Who will work under this is the family or community labor. So first category of farming is primitive subsistence farming. The primitive subsistence farming is also known as slash and burn agriculture. It is basically done in the monsoon, natural fertility of the soil and suitability of other environmental conditions. What are the tools that they use is hoe, dao and the digging sticks. Who work here is family or community labor. The productivity of the land is very low because they don't use any other fertilizers. What are the different names of slash and burn agriculture in different parts of the world? The slash and burn agriculture is known as milpa in Mexico. It is known as conqua in Venezuela, roca in Brazil, mussol in Central Africa, Ladang in Indonesia, Ray in Vietnam, And in India, this farm is called as Bewar or Dahia in Madhya Pradesh, Podu or Penda in Andhra Pradesh, Pama Dabi or Koman Bringa in Orissa, Kumari in West Bengal, Ghats or Western Ghats region, Kumari in Western Ghats region, Valer, Valtre in southeastern Rajasthan, Kil in the Himalayan belt, Kurwa in Jharkhand, Jomming in northeastern region. Now moving on to intense subsistence farming. This intensive subsistence farming is practiced in the areas where high population pressure on the land. What is the meaning of high population pressure on the land? The meaning of high pressure population on the land is there is a lot of expectation because there is a lot of population around the land. There is pressure on the land that they have to produce more. So, they need labor intense farm. It is basically they need a lot of labor. High doses of biochemical inputs and irrigation are used for obtaining high production or higher production. As we all know, the right of inheritance is a right given to a family members. The male person gets the family more properties when compared to women, especially the farmlands and all. So the right of inheritance is leading to the division of lands among successive generations have rendered land holding size uneconomical. Like for example, if a family has two children and the father owns 2 acres of land, naturally when it is given to the both the children, the land holding, both the children will divide it into 2 1-acre lands. And if again they are getting married and each person has 2 children, again the land holding size becomes to 1/2 acre per child. This is becoming the problem with the average land holding size. Because when you produce in 1/2 acre, you will not be able to produce economically worth towards the requirements for us. And there is a lot of pressure on agricultural land. Intensive subsistence farming is practiced in the areas of high population pressure on land. It is a labor intensive farming. High doses of biochemical inputs and irrigation are used for obtaining high production. Right of inheritance leading to the division of land among successive generations has rendered land holding size uneconomical. Enormous pressure is there on the agricultural land. Commercial farming. What is commercial farming? They use higher doses of modern inputs. Example, the high yielding variety seeds. Basically, this is done for commercial purpose. A plantations. What are plantations, first of all? A plantation is a large tract of field where a single particular crop is grown by using huge labor and high quality of seeds only to produce huge profits. That kind of plantation, that kind of crop area is called plantation. Basically, plantations cover large tracts of land using capital intensive inputs with the help of migrant laborers. Actually, this is started by Britishers in our country. They used to force Indians to produce cotton, tea and indigo for their company products or for their company's raw materials. Coming to our topic here, commercial farming, they use high doses of modern inputs like high yielding variety seeds, chemical fertilizers, insecticides and pesticides in order to obtain high productivity. Rice is one such commercial crop in Haryana and Punjab, while in Orissa it is a subsistence crop. Plantation commercial farming, where a single crop is grown in a large area. India has basically three cropping seasons: Kharif, Rabi and Zayan. The Kharif season starts with the onset of monsoons in different parts of the country. These are harvested from September to October. The major important crops which are grown during the paddy during this particular season, that is Kharif season, is paddy, maize, jowar, bajra, tur, moong, urud, cotton, jute, groundnut and soyabean. The most important rice growing regions are Assam, West Bengal, coastal regions of Orissa and Andhra Pradesh. Now moving to the second important season, that is Rabi season. The Rabi season starts in October and it continues till December. Mostly this crop is harvested during April to June. The most important crops which are grown in the Rabi season are wheat, barley, pias, gram and mustard. States from the north, northwestern parts such as Punjab, Haryana, Himachal Pradesh, Jammu and Kashmir are the states where they mostly produce during the Rabi season. Because the availability of precipitation during winter months due to the western time temperate cyclones helps in the success of these particular crops. And the last season, that is summer month season, Zaid. Zaid season are the crops produced during the summer months of April, May and June. The crops which are produced are watermelon, muskmelon, cucumber. These are the major crops which are produced during the Zaid season. So in India we have basically three cropping seasons: Kharif, Rabi and Zaid. Major crops in India. The major crops in India can be broadly categorized into two groups. One is the food, the other one is non-food crops. Food crops include rice, wheat, millets, maize, pulses. Food crops other than grains include sugarcane, oil seeds, tea, coffee and horticulture. Let us see each one in detail. First crop is rice. In this chapter, we are trying to study the features which are suitable for a rice crop to be grown. Basically, in India, the staple food crop of majority of people in India is rice. Our country is the second largest producer of rice in the world after China. Now, this is basically done in the Kharif crop time. That is, as we discussed the season, the first season, as the monsoons onset, we have the Kharif season. Because for the rice crop, we need very high temperatures, that is above 25 degrees of Celsius. And also we need high humidity with annual rainfall above 100 centimeters. In case if there is no rainfall, they depend on irrigation facilities. It is mostly grown in the coastal areas and the deltaic regions. With the help of irrigation and tube wells, it is possible to grow rice in the areas of less rainfall such as Punjab, Haryana and western Uttar Pradesh parts and also in some regions of Rajasthan. So the first crop what we are discussing here is a crop in which season it is grown. What are the climatic conditions that are required? Which areas are suitable for this particular crop to be cultivated? This particular crop, what we do first is rice, because it is a staple food of majority of Indians. Our country is the second largest producer of rice in the world. it's produced in the Kharif season. It requires high temperatures above 25, high humidity, and with an annual rainfall above 100 centimeters. If it is no rainfall dependent, then we depend on irrigation water supply, because there are cases where there is no rainfall during that particular season, but still they produce a rice crop with good amount of output depending on irrigation and tube wells. It grows mostly in coastal areas or deltaic regions. Next crop what we are going to discuss is wheat. The wheat is the second most important cereal crop in our country. This crop is the main food crop in north and northwestern part of the country. It is produced during the Rabi crop season. It also requires, the climatic conditions are cool growing season and a bright sunshine at the time of ripening. It requires annual rainfall ranging from 50 centimeters to 75 centimeters, eventually distributed over the growing season. The Ganga and Satluj plain are the regions where it is mostly cultivated. The major producing wheat producing states are Haryana, Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, and Rajasthan. For any crop, we need to remember the which season crop it is, what are the climatic conditions that are required, which area is it suitable for grown. For example, here you can see the season is Rabi crop. It requires sunshine and cool growing. While it is growing, it needs cool weather. While it is ripening, it needs bright sunshine. It requires, let us say, average rainfall 50 to 75, and it is mostly grown in the Ganga Satluj plain, and the states are Punjab, Haryana, Uttar Pradesh, Madhya Pradesh, Bihar, and Rajasthan. Sugarcane crop. Each case one example we have taken. So one, the non-food crops is sugarcane crop, non-grain crop, sorry. It is basically tropical as well as subtropical crop. So it can be grown in tropical climatic conditions and also in subtropical climatic conditions. Why it is like that? Because it needs hot and humid climate. The temperature requirement for the sugarcane crop is 21 degrees Celsius to 27 degrees Celsius. So in the semi-tropical regions also you will have temperatures up to 23 degrees. So that also is suitable for sugarcane crop. The annual rainfall between 75 centimeters to 100 centimeters. Irrigation is required in the regions of low rainfall, variety of soils, and needs manual labor for this crop cultivation. India is the second largest producer of sugarcane only after Brazil. The main source of sugar is gur, the jaggery, kansari, or molasses. The states which grow sugarcane crop are Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, Bihar, Punjab, and Haryana. Now, what are the other types of farmings that we have? Let us start from the top. Aviculture. If you are doing bird farming, it is called aviculture. If you are producing vegetables and fruit farming, it is called horticulture. If you are producing aqua fish farming, it is called aquaculture. If you are producing only fruits, then it is called fruticulture. If you are producing flowers, it is called floriculture. If you are rearing animals, it's called animal husbandry. If you are doing bee farming, it's called apiculture. If you are doing tree farming, arboriculture. If you are doing mushroom farming, it is called fungiculture. If you are doing grapes farming, it is called viniculture. If you are doing silk farming, it is called sericulture. If you are doing fish farming, only particular fish farming if you are doing apart from the other types of prawns and all, then that is called pisciculture. So like this, we have so many types of cultures basing on what type of farming are we doing. Now, technological and institutional reforms. Agriculture has been practiced in India from thousands of years. A land without compatible technological institutions change has hindered the pace of the development of agriculture. In spite of development of sources of irrigation, most of the farmers in our country still depend on monsoons and natural fertility in order to carry on their agriculture. Agriculture, which provides livelihood for more than 60% of the population, needs some serious technical and institutional reforms to be done. One such good example what we have practiced is green revolution based on the use of package technology and white revolution, that is Operation Flood. Now, what are the changes that can be brought? Collectivization, consolidation of holdings, cooperation, abolition of zamindari system are few of the steps which are given priority to bring about institutional reforms in our country after independence. The second plan what is done is land reforms was the main focus in our first 5-year plan. The right of inheritance is one reason why we have less productivity. The agricultural reforms are needed to improve Indian agriculture in the year 1960s and 70s, and one great step taken by the government of India is during 1963, that is the Green Revolution, which revolutionized the entire agricultural field because they used high yielding variety of seeds, good supply of water, the irrigation, made drastic changes and use of fertilizers and pesticides to prevent them from any kind of diseases or pesticides. All has saved the agriculture crops. So these are the major issues which are being dealt. And in 1980s and 90s, the Comprehensive Land Development Program was initiated, which includes both institutional and technical reforms which have to be taken. Provisions from crop insurance against the drought, flood, cyclone, fire and diseases. It's a very great step which is required in all fields and crops, that is, you should have insurance for the crop if you are getting through drought, if it is a failure of rains in the proper time, you get insured. Floods come, over rains, cyclones, suddenly nobody can control them, so natural disasters, fire breakouts or any kind of diseases which come, we need to have insurance. The second step which is taken by the government is providing loan facilities to the farmers at very low rates of interest. This is highly important. There is one chapter which we dealt exclusively about money and credit, where we learned that Indians are struggling with the money lenders in the rural areas. They charge very, very high rates of interest. And we also need to, the third step is Kisan credit cards. Personal accident insurance schemes are some of the other schemes which the government has given to the farmers. And also we need to release special weather bulletins, whether they can believe in this rain or not, whether they will have rain in this particular week or not. The forecast has to be given based on the crops. Is it suitable for this particular crop or not? All these will help the farmers to learn certain things and plan according to that to their cropping. Government also announces minimum support price and remunerative procurement prices for important crops to check the exploitation of farmers by the speculators. So from 1980s onwards, government has taken many steps. The first is land development and program, which is both institutional and technical, giving insurance to the crops, giving loan facilities, giving credit cards and accidental insurance schemes for individuals, special weather bulletins, and also government announcing minimum support price, remunerative and procurement prices for the crops to check the exploitation done to the farmers by the speculators or the middlemen. Now we are going to discuss about a bloodless revolution which occurred in our country, that is Bhutan movement. Vinoba Bhave, a great devotee or a practitioner of Gandhiji's ideology, who one day he was traveling in Pochampalli, is one of the regions in Andhra Pradesh. There, some poor landless villagers demanded some land for their economic well-being. He promised that he will talk to the government of India regarding the provisions of land for them. An individual named Sri Ramachandra Reddy stood up immediately and offered 80 acres of land to be distributed among the 80 landless villagers. Getting struck by this act, Vinoba Bhave wanted to appeal to all the rich elite group to help the landless people by holding certain amounts of land for themselves and the family benefits and give it to them, the other things to the landless people. This act is called Bhudan. You are donating the land to the poor. So Bhudan, you are giving it as a donation. Zamindars, owners of many villages, offered to distribute some villages among the to the landless. And Mahatma Gandhi declared Vinoba Bhave as his spiritual heir. Votaries of Gandhiji's concept of Grama Swaraj, Gandhiji was martyred and Vinoba Bhave undertook the Padayatra to spread the Gandhiji's message, covered almost the entire country. And this Bhudan Gramdan movement initiated by Vinoba Bhave is also known as the bloodless revolution. We have great people and great donors in our country from ancient time to present day. Let us all salute to all those people who have donated their lands just on an appeal made by one follower of Gandhiji, that is Vinoba Bhave, who gives lands, acres and acres of land, just for a call. Let's all salute for their sincerity and appreciation to being as a human and want to help other people. As there is a situation here, they have an opportunity, they never turn back. Let us say zamindars, owners, whoever it is. Great movement which happened in our country. Contribution of agriculture to the national economy, employment and output. Agriculture has been the backbone of our country from the ancient time. The GDP, gross domestic product, has registered a declining trend from 1951 onwards. In 2010-11, about 52% of the total workforce depend on agriculture. The declining shares of agriculture in the GDP is a matter of serious concern, because any decline and stagnation in the GDP of agriculture reflects on majority of people's lives. Indian Council of Agricultural Research, ICAR, agricultural universities and veterinary services, animal breeding centers, horticulture development centers, research and development institutions have been set up to find out about the meteorology and weather forecast situation. Because the growth rate of agriculture has been decelerating with an alarming situation, where the Indian farmers are facing a big challenge from international competition. Subsidy of fertilizers is decreased, leading to increase in the cost of production. reduction in import duties on agricultural products have proved detrimental to agriculture in the country. So in our country, agriculture will lead to a decline in other spheres of the economy, having wider implications for society. These are the contributions, and the studies reveal that we need to take serious steps, because the contribution of agriculture to GDP is reducing, and we all need to remember that agriculture has always been the backbone of the country. The impact of globalization on agriculture. Globalization is not a new phenomenon for us. Indian spices were exported to different countries from the ancient time. Cotton was exported to Britain as a raw material for the textile industry. The cotton textile industries in Manchester and Liverpool flourished due to the availability of good quality of cotton from India, which proves that India produces the fine quality of cotton even today. From 1990s, the farmers in India have been exposed to a new, great, tough challenge. Being an important producer of rice, cotton, rubber, tea, coffee, jute and spice, our agricultural products are not able to compete with the developed countries. India is the second largest producer in rice, cotton, sugar, but still we are not able to compete with the developed countries. Why? Because the farmers are forced to grow indigo on their lands while they are in the British rule, because it is required for their industry. During the Champaran movement in 1917, we had a similar kind of situation. So the growth of the foreign countries' requirements in our country is not a new. Let's say it's in the colonial period, or now we are competing with the other countries' products because the import duties on those products has been slashed down. With the mutual trades with the other countries, the bilateral trade agreements have brought many challenges to Indian farmers. That's the impact of globalization on agriculture. Today's Indian agriculture. To make agriculture successful and profitable, what all steps that India has to take? The Green Revolution has promised much. We have learned certain things. It has given us a confidence. Through experiment and practice, we can make agriculture a successful and a profitable one. That is Green Revolution's promise and confidence what it has given to us. It is being alleged that it has caused land degradation due to the overuse of chemicals, drying aquifers and vanishing biodiversity. Yes, for anything we try to do, we'll always have the consequences in place. So if you practice more Green Revolution, the land degradation, overuse of chemicals are the negative implications what we'll have in our land. Next, what then we can do? The organic farming, which is much practiced today in our country, because there is nothing made with the chemicals, made up of factories or pesticides or fertilizers, which is very good for agriculture. An average of less than half an acre is a land holding size of an individual in our country. Biodiesel crops have to be grown more, like jatropha and jojoba, which needs much less water for irrigation than rice and sugarcane. So this can be done in the less availability of water areas. And the next, Indian farmers should diversify their cropping pattern from cereals to high value crops. We need to have a multiple crops during the three seasons on the land. You need to produce three different types of crops, which gives you more output. At the same time, you will get more profit. India's diverse climatic condition has given the opportunity for us to grow a wide variety of high value crops. So India's diversified climatic condition has to be used as an advantage for us. So today's India's agriculture has to be made successful and profitable. We have seen the cases with Green Revolution. Once we are being successful, though we had consequences, we need to practice organic farming. We need to increase the average landholding size of an individual, which is only half an acre. Then we need to produce a crop such as biodiesel crops, which are eco-friendly, which needs less irrigation water when compared to rice and sugarcane. And with the diverse climatic condition what we have, extreme hot, extreme cold, extremely rainy climatic conditions, extremely dry climatic conditions, semi-arid climatic conditions, all these have to be used as an advantage for us. And then we have to produce wide variety of crops. These are the key points what we have in this chapter. Thank you very much for watching Hamsika Academy. Please subscribe.